Most of the great bands today serve a double function. First, they're self-contained musical units, ringing as much sheer sound from their amplifiers as an audience can bear. Second, they're conveyors of energy, wizards if you will, restoring to modern music some of the magic it traded for the finesse of a concert hall. Most kids today treat their instruments the way their older brothers treated their cars, as sort of sacred extensions of their personality, not just machines. So a successful rock group has to combine technical virtuosity with a savage kind of grace. Superstars affect the transference of energy. They've got to be erotic in the widest, wildest sense of that word. At their best, the Doors are certainly that. There's nothing superfluous about their sound, just three instruments and a voice, tough, tight, together. John Densmore on drums, Robbie Krieger on guitar, organist Ray Manzarek fills in the bottom, and Jim Morrison, the lead singer, seems to sit astride the music, his body amplified by the sound. To some critics, Morrison is guilty of gross excess. They see him as a sort of latter-day Isadora Duncan without a bosom worth bearing. But when the timing and the tempo are right, Jim Morrison can transform rock into something more than words and music, something magic. Of course, it all depends on your willingness to be spellbound. You might call him theatrical, or you might call him religious, but he's more than your folks bargained for when they bought your first transistor radio, and that's enough. I'm going to be discussing the Doors and the response their music produces with Pat Kennealy, editor of Jazz and Pop, Rosko, noted MC and disc jockey on WNEW-FM, and Al Aronowitz, who has written pop criticism for the New York Times and Life magazine. Okay, let's talk about the Doors. They begin at UCLA, where Morrison and Manzarek are enrolled in a master's program in filmmaking. They share a house in Venice, California, near the beach. Ray introduces his friends Krieger and Densmore to Jim's poetry. They begin to jam together at small clubs on the Sunset Strip. And even in their early tapes, there's a distinct bluesy feeling, which sometimes gets lost in the poetics, but usually comes out in the rhythm where it counts. Anyway, a huge record company signs them, then changes its mind. Another company grabs them up, and this time they record. Their first album sells more copies than My Weekly Reader. They become superstars, able to leap tall groupies in a single bound, able to fill virtually any hall in the Western world. They garner as much publicity from their presence as they do from their music. This seems to put the authorities uptight, but it delights the kids. It's like Jim Morrison once said, when you make your peace with authority, you become an authority. I interviewed the Doors when they were in town a few weeks ago, and I'd like to run some of that tape for you now.
I think in a way, rock concerts have always served a function. It gives a lot of people with the same station in life a chance to gather together and kind of assemble and just feel the sheer mass of them that exists, the numbers.
And that's a good point.
Yeah, on the other hand, you can take that, the 10,000 people coming together, and there's a sense of communion, a communal thing. We're all here together, and there's no reason. A lot of energy is dissipated in the concert, but there's no reason that that same communal kind of thing can't be taken out into the outside world. And ideally, hopefully, that's what a good rock concert can do. People are together inside, and they get outside into the parking lot and start driving home and get into their homes. I hope they still realize that they're together. You know, they were together in the concert, and they're together in their homes, they're together in their schools, they're together on the street. And if the people can work that togetherness, to keep that thing going and working it, eventually everything's going to turn out all right.
You get a community feeling there.
Yeah.
A contact high, so to speak.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I once wrote a piece on you called The Shaman as Superstar, in which I suggested that rock musicians, rock heroes, perform a religious function for kids, for young people. Do you sometimes see your concerts as a sort of ritual?
Yeah. Yeah, it's a funny thing. I've read a little bit about shamanism. I haven't seen too much of it firsthand, except, you know, what we see with the music and that kind of thing. But in tribes, the shaman could be any age, could be an old man or a young man, but the whole tribe, all ages, kind of tried to push him into his trip and listen to him. Irregardless, it was just a question of a certain psychological tendency in an individual.
Do you think the role of a rock shaman is in a time of, say, social turmoil with kids taking things into their own hands, more or less?
I don't think the shaman, from what I've read, is really too interested in defining his role in society. He's just more interested in pursuing his own fantasies. And if he became too self-conscious of a function, you know, I think it might tend to ruin his own inner trip.
I think that's why a lot of rock people have been reluctant to get involved in issue-oriented politics, you know, make statements on the school crisis and what have you, you know.
Oh, a lot of people just aren't interested in politics at all.
Well, as you go around the world, as you travel through Europe and America, what do kids look to you for as far as projecting through your sounds?
It's funny, in Europe, that the kids were much more politically oriented. You know, if we said anything politically, they'd go into a furor, you know. I mean, they love it, you know, especially anything against America, you know. But if we just played, they'd dig that too, but they really dug the political side of it, you know. But in America, it's just the opposite, really. A lot of people are, at our concerts at least, they're sort of, it seems like they don't really come to hear us speak politics. You
know? What do they come to hear? I mean,
well,
I know you can just say
I think they come more for the religious experience.
How does that translate in terms of rhythm, riffs, and things like that?
You really can't, not because specific. Any rhythm, any riff, any set of lyrics is a release. You know, it's just if you're releasing yourself totally into whatever you happen to be playing at the moment.
How about in lyrics? What's the difference between a rock lyric and a poem? Well,
there's really no difference. You know, Jim's book is the same as Jim's lyrics. You know, this I can read a page, and I've heard him sing pretty much the same things. You know, for him, I don't think it's any difference at all. This is written poetry, and what he does on stage is spoken poetry. Mm. And spoken poetry is very effective. Although some poems read better than they speak, but for the most part, spoken poetry is much more effective.
What we do sometimes is, like, we'll play a song, and we'll play the structure and of the song, and then we'll get into a free part, and we'll improvise musically, and he'll improvise lyrically, and that will probably be just straight poetry, you know. And then we'll get back into the form later.
It would naturally seem much more fluid than what you've got in the book there.
A lot of our most interesting songs develop over a period of time, playing night after night in clubs. We'd start out into a fairly basic song, and then the music would settle into a kind of hypnotic river of sound, which would leave me free to kind of make up anything that came into my head at the time. I like songs, but that's the part of the performance that I enjoy the most, where I have a chance just to pick up vibrations from the music and what's coming from the audience, and just kind of follow it wherever it goes.
How's that different from how you write a poem?
It's very similar. I think a lot of poetry is very close to music, except when you write a poem, often you have to be in a state of mind that music can put you in with its hypnotic quality that leaves you free to, you know, just let the subconscious play itself out wherever it goes. I really admire poets who can get up with just with or without a microphone, just in front of a group of people and start reciting their poetry. I really admire that, but I find it, the music gives me a kind of security that makes it a lot easier to express myself, whereas it's, you know, kind of hard just to read it dry.
Sure.
You know.
Yeah.
I wish I could. I'd like to work on that a little bit more. You know. Mm-hmm.
I think one of the trends which are pretty evident in rock now is that it's becoming demystified. A lot of things about kids are becoming the mystery is being extracted from them, and we're getting very concerned with words like honest music or down home music or things like that. You know, how does this affect your stuff?
I was talking about that this weekend, thinking a lot about it. I think the two basic types of music indigenous to this country are black music, blues, and the kind of folk music that was brought over from Europe, and I guess they call it country music, or the kind of West Virginia high and lonesome sound. That those are the two main streams of root American music. There might be others, I don't know, but it looks like, and like 10 years ago, what they called rock and roll was kind of a blending of those two forms. And I guess what's happening now is that rock is kind of dying out, and everyone is going back to the roots again. Some are going back into country, and some are going back into basic blues. I guess in 4 or 5 years, the new generation's music will be, it'll have a synthesis of those two elements and some third thing that'll be entire. Maybe it'll be, it might rely heavily on electronics, tapes. I can kind of envision maybe one person with a lot of machines, tapes, and electronic setups. Singing or speaking and using machines.
We used to think that rock was progressing, you know, it was a line from some point to another, but instead it's a wave, really. Mm-hmm. And there's a return, you know, to
Well, that's why I like blues and jazz musicians and country musicians. They just keep on exploring their own music. Sometimes they're right on time, and the public finds something in it that expresses the time, and sometimes they're out of favor. But I think for musicians and poets, artists in general, is just to keep exploring their own field, and if you're popular, go with it. And if you go out of favor, just keep doing it, you know?